Motor City Comic Con Sunday. How are you guys doing today? That was weak. For Detroit, that was weak. Let's try that one more time. Motor City Comic Con. How are my nerds doing? Well done. Thank you. Thank you. Well, you guys, it's already been a great con, and it's going to continue because we have an amazing panel lined up, and I hope you guys have some questions that you want to ask as well, because we have a microphone right there in the middle of the room, so feel free, line up now, get your questions ready, and this is really going to be your time to talk to this awesome lady. So, oh, and also, keep in mind, you've got those cell phones and smartphones in your pockets, maybe a tablet. Bust those out, use hashtag MCCC, and share the conversation with your friends at home, and let them know this is what they're missing out on when they're not at Comic-Con. All right, without further ado, let me go ahead and bring her out. You know her, of course, from Caroline in the City. You know her, of course, from Some Kind of Wonderful, from the ABC Family / Freeform Network show, Switched at Birth. You know her from Space Camp. You know her from Howard the Duck. You know her from Back to the Future. Sometimes it feels like we're getting a little too close to this.
Yeah.
That was where they really predicted the future, that red comb over.
Yeah. Well, I know.
Reminiscent of what's going on right now.
I know it's a story you've told before, but I'm going to ask you to share it again because I happen to love it. You've mentioned that your sort of favorite incarnation of Lorraine was Biff World, and it's something that is still represented in your reel today, right?
Yeah, I mean, I was only, 25 when I played Lorraine McFly at the old age of 47. And I've always wanted to play that character again, the one that was, you were the one who wanted me to have these things. Back, take them. I want to play that girl. So I keep her on my reel and still, yeah. People keep casting me as little Miss Mary Sunshine. Gosh darn it. Yeah. I wonder why.
What is sort of the darkest that you've had to go in your work? When have you really been able to plumb that kind of like, that dark side?
Well, not too often, really. I mean, maybe I did Cabaret here in Detroit. I did it on tour and then I did it on Broadway. So that was really, for like 8 months, that was a pretty sad part, but you know, in a way I kind of like doing entertainment that is positive, you know, and uplifting. I don't know, I kind of like putting that stuff in the world, so probably that's why I get those kind of parts, because I don't know, it makes me feel so happy when you guys come up to me and say that a role helped you get through a hard time or a sickness, and I don't know, that's just such an immense gift. For me, as a person, to think that I've been helpful. But maybe, there are dark roles that are still uplifting, so I want one of those.
Yeah. Well, we spoke in 2015 a couple times about the Back to the Future 30th anniversary, and in October, there was that the lead up to Back to the Future Day, where suddenly you're seeing all these commercials for Pepsi Perfect or for the Nike shoes or all of those things. When you're watching that, what was sort of striking you as the most surreal kind of product that they brought to light? Because even like they had the USA Today cover, that was a front cover from the movie 2015. So what was just sort of the most surreal thing that you encountered?
Well, the most surreal thing is that people still love the movie and that they show it to their kids and their grandkids and their, in the case of my mother-in-law, their great-granddaughter. And for me, you just when you're making a movie, you don't think that it's gonna end up like that. I mean, even Bob Zemeckis, who's made great, great, great movies, is shocked that he really believes that this is probably the movie that he'll be most known for. And we're all just like, that's what's surreal, that's what's so beautiful, and to live long enough to see that, and is something you don't think about when you're just, you know, I'm getting flunked. you don't think about that when you're just showing up for your work, you know, and it's a gift.
Yeah.
It really is.
Well, let's go ahead and throw it to a question from the audience. Hi there.
Hi. Hi. We met earlier, and I'm a Switched at Birth fan. There was an episode when I think his name was Lorenzo, and you were in the dancing mode and this and that. Do you ever feel like you want to do that in real life? Just go out and
dance?
Kind of have a moment all to yourself, you know?
Oh, yeah. I do.
Do something winful.
I do. I think a thing with like mothers and women are like just work, 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 work. So, yeah. I mean, I love the character in Switched at Birth because she, I did this show Switched at Birth for 5 years, and this character was seen kind of uptight, but she kept trying new things. I think that the writers were trying to get me to sing and dance and do all the different things that I do, but I think it was nice because I think it inspired me and maybe people who are watching it to like try new things, keep exploring, keep learning, keep trying scary things. And I learned that from the character.
Well, you know, I think like across the board, your work, it's now touching this next generation as well. Like I grew up, I'm part of the Back to the Future generation, but now Switched at Birth is part of this kind of next round. What are you finding a shift in sort of fandom or people that come up to you and talk about your work? Is it still primarily Back to the Future? Is it Space Camp? Is it Caroline the City? Or is it, like, what is it?
I'm just really lucky because I do span a really broad spectrum of things. But what I actually find really weird right now is, like, all of the Howard the Duck fans have come out of the closet. Yeah. I mean, everybody was so scared. For some reason, I think when they put him in Guardians of the Galaxy, everybody got, like, not scared to like Howard the Duck, which even me, you know, because everybody who interviews me will always be like they're going to get me. Like, you know, they're going to bring up Howard the Duck and I'm going to start to cry. I'm like, no, I own it, I wear it, I made it, it's cool. And I have the best fans. So that's been the weird thing that's been happening lately is kind of a political correctness about being Howard the Duck fan, which I really enjoy.
I have a fondness for Howard the Duck because, you know, when I watched it as a kid, like, I laughed. Like, it provided me with entertainment, you know? And no, I would not say it's a perfect movie, but I have a fondness for it. Do you still have, like, what is sort of the memory that springs to mind when someone mentions Howard the Duck? What is your recollection that you're personally kind of connected to?
I was half naked, strapped to a table for a month.
Okay.
That's what I remember. I was very, very cold. I was just coughing and they would throw a blanket over me and that big last scene with the thing and the thing. I was like, ah! That's what I remember, being very cold. But
do you think it made you a better actor? Because that's not an easy challenge to be, you know, acting opposite a duck.
Making a duck sexy.
Making a duck
that
sexy.
Requires a special skill set. I actually have 7 ducks right now, white ducks. 5, 4, 6 boy ducks and 1 poor girl duck. Aww. Right now.
Do you know who the father is?
Hi.
Hi. I'm sure there's tons of stories that you can tell from being on set of the movie, but what's one of your favorite behind-the-scenes moments from the first Back to the Future?
My favorite memory is that I had all this makeup on in the first scene when you meet George and Lorraine, and I have the cake, and I'm like, Uncle Jailbird Joey didn't make parole again. When we did that scene, well, they glue that makeup on your face, and you have to be really careful because it's a long day, and if you lift the makeup off your face, they have to start over and the day's ruined. So we couldn't laugh or make too many expressions, and Crispin Glover kept watching the honeymooners going like this. And we couldn't stop laughing, so I was like this. And it got really late in the evening, but that was a great day because that was a funny scene, and he was really funny, and I had my Papaw vodka, and I was ready.
Was that application better or worse than the makeup for Back to the Future 2? Had it gotten a little bit easier for you a couple years later?
Well, yes, it got easier for the Back to the Future 2 and 3 because there was another makeup artist. The makeup artist was really mean. So when you have to sit there in someone's space for 3 hours and they're, you know, because it's 3 hours.
Yeah.
You're just sitting there. It's horrible.
Yeah.
Someone's crabby. No good.
Yeah, no fun. Hi there.
Hi. First of all, thanks for coming out and hanging out with all of us this weekend. Appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you.
My question is about Back to the Future. I guess it's fairly well known that you guys started out with Eric Stoltz instead of Michael J. Fox. It's been kind of one of those things that's always sort of fascinated me, that, you know, you filmed this stuff and apparently it wasn't working and then they moved to Michael J. Fox. I guess my question for you is kind of two-layered. One, did you feel that maybe, did you have any, like, on-screen chemistry with him? I mean, because I think you guys filmed a couple scenes together before they scrapped it. And had they gone that direction, if Michael J. Fox wasn't available, do you think the film would, I don't think it would have been as much of a success, but would it have had some sort of resonance with fans today if they had gone that route, based on your experiences with it?
Yeah, Eric Stoltz shot for 6 whole weeks, Back to the Future, and I had already done a movie with him called The Wildlife, so we were already really good friends. But Eric just had this, when you watch the movie, you realize that everyone has this kind of like larger-than-life acting style. Crispin Glover is kind of doing Commedia dell'arte, big gestures and things, and he was very, and he did that on purpose. And I was doing a very stylized performance, and Chris Lloyd was like, I gotta go, I have forever, you know. He was like doing all this exposition in the fastest, biggest way possible. We've gotta get this, and it's gotta go, like really hard, but it was very, very big styles. And Eric Stoltz was trying to do some kind of like method performance, like a real serious actor, and it just wasn't right. And then, so when Michael Fox came in, and Michael Fox was kind of doing like a Buster Keaton kind of, you know, every single move he choreographed, he would choreograph everything he did. And I thought it was really crazy when I was watching it. I was like, that is so overplanned, like, oh my God. But to this day, I can see how he was doing like a really old-fashioned, 1930s kind of, you know, James Cagney kind of thing, and the double take, and the spit take, and the fall over, and the classics. So he really embedded the movie with this kind of, you know, engine that made it less serious and kept people's minds off of the real darker elements of the story. But they were, you know, they're both really good, but yeah, I don't think it would have been as big of a hit with Eric, for sure.
Yeah.
Long answer?
Well, what's kind of interesting about that is that it was sort of this well-known open secret for a while, and then with the DVD for the 25th anniversary, I think they finally just started showing they put the footage on that DVD.
Yeah.
And it's kind of nice because it's just sort of out in the open now, and you guys can go check it out and get that DVD.
It's really cool.
And check it out.
I mean, Eric Stoltz is super handsome. I mean, he was, and I did a movie, Some Kind of Wonderful, with him afterwards too. He's really good.
It's a great actor.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hi there.
Hi.
Could someone help this young person with the? There you go.
First of all, I love your work in all the Back to the Futures. I have two questions. One, what was your favorite part in filming any of them in any of the Back to the Future movies?
My favorite part? You know, I love the whole car scene in Back to the Future 1 because there was like these incredible plot points that had to be sold with just a look, with just acting, where I had to fall out of love with my son and in love with my future husband. And that whole scene is so, when Crispin like reaches down and I look up at him and I had to sell that I fell in love with him at that one moment. And it's just such a beautifully constructed 3 or 4 minutes of film. That's my favorite part. Thanks.
And what was your favorite Back to the Future movie?
I think Back to the Future 1, I mean, people study it in film school as a perfect script. You know, obviously, a perfect script isn't just written. It was perfected as we were shooting. But Back to the Future 1, I'd say. What great questions.
Thank you
and
very much.
One more question.
Oh, okay.
Who was your favorite actor to work with on the movies?
Now that gets tough.
It's not being filmed, is it?
The internet is everywhere.
My favorite actor. Well, it's funny because Chris Lloyd is like my best friend now from the movie because I see him a lot in these things. And but I did like 7 movies with Chris Lloyd in only one scene. And that's in Back to the Future 1. I never got to act with him. So I guess at the time, probably Crispin. Crispin Glover was, because we had the most scenes together, and he was so eccentric. Like, unbelievably eccentric.
Weird.
When we had to do the last scene of Back to the Future where we're the couple, the like tennis-playing couple, he had a lot of trouble with that character, so he invited me over to his house, which was painted completely black lacquer, with nothing but a 1930s gynecological table in the middle of the true story. And we, in order to do some character research, we painted a volcano. That's how we came up with two fabulous middle-class, middle-aged people. And he was so eccentric and such a genius, and I had a lot of fun with him. Yeah. Thank you for your beautiful question.
How was your volcano work?
My mother painted over this volcano. It was such a terrible painting. She was like, I'm going to paint over this.
Hello.
Hi, welcome. My question is for your time on Switched at Birth. Did you know sign language before you started it, or did you have to learn it, and how long did it take you to learn it?
I am watching her. Thank you very much. What's your name?
Lisa.
Lisa's doing a beautiful job here. I didn't know any sign language. In Switch of Birth, I have a deaf daughter, and so we did a whole silent episode where we signed. And it's an incredibly beloved show by the deaf community because we represent the people of the deaf community as just kind of people. And so we all had to learn sign language, and I'm still not great at it. I can communicate, but it's harder for me to read it. And I'm really sorry about that because I've spent 5 years learning it. But anyway, I can still communicate pretty well. And I loved learning it. And I love that so many people are inspired to learn it and try to communicate.
Thank you. Hello.
All right, I'm a deaf person. And someone stole my voice. Anyways, who taught you ASL?
Well, mostly Marley Matlin's coach, Jack. And they had different coaches all the time, but Jack's the one that, he sent me little videos every single scene and he'd teach me. And then, because a lot of people don't realize, sign language there's many different ways to say the same thing. I always try to find the one that hurts my hands the least. It's like some of this really hurts me. So I try to, one of the actresses got carpal tunnel.
Yes.
From learning. It's harder on older people.
Okay.
But we have many, many beautiful people teaching us.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you remember the sign from the show? Can you still keep it up and sign?
Yeah, a little bit. I remember Switched at Birth. I remember, you look handsome.
Do you know that one?
No. What did he say?
That's all right, I was just testing.
I told, at least I copped to it, that I wasn't good at it. See, he's fingerspelling now.
And are you close friends with Charlie Sheen?
Oh, no, I'm not close friends with Charlie. My life is too short. My life is too short. But I did do Red Dawn with him, and we were fellow Wolverines!
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I do recognize that. I failed my test. Thank God I copped to it. Hi.
Hello. I'm Trent.
Hi, Trent.
I have two questions.
Okay.
Related to the movie. I want to know if you can share with us your perspective about the movie Red Dawn.
My perspective of Red Dawn. Well, Red Dawn was the most fun I ever had making a movie because I got to basically go to camp for 3 months and hang out with some really fun people who were out of control. And the audition for Red Dawn, the director asked me 3 questions. Can you ride a horse? Can you shoot a gun? And have you ever eaten squirrel? I'm from Minnesota, so yes, I have eaten squirrel. So that's how I passed that audition. I mean, it was a strange movie. Basically, it was someone's nightmare, and that's where the idea came from for the original script.
Okay, now my next question. I want to ask you about the movie Jaws 3. How do you feel about that movie? I want you to be honest.
These are hard-hitting questions.
These are hard-hitting. It's pretty much the greatest movie ever made. And I was a genius in that pink bathing suit. It was my first movie, so that's my disclaimer here. And it wasn't scary. That was the worst thing about it. But I did ski on a 3-tier water ski pyramid on the ocean. So I stood on a little girl's, 2 little girls' shoulders, bare shoulders, on the ocean, and didn't die.
Yay!
Come on, stunts. What can I say?
And let's face it, without Jaws 3D, we wouldn't have Jaws 19. So it really sets the stage. So. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have 2 questions. My first one is, what got you into acting in the first place?
I was a dancer in a ballet company, and they owed a theater money. So they said, since you can't pay us back, you have to loan us your dancer to star in The Little Mermaid. So that's how I got my first acting job. Because after like a half an hour, they cut my tongue out and I didn't have to talk, so I just had to dance around. But I went to New York and I was a ballet dancer, but I really wasn't good enough. So I quit and I started acting, and that came really quickly to me. I got jobs right away, so It was kind of like my second dream, which happens, I think, a lot with a lot of people. The thing you think you want to do the most ends up not being the thing you end up doing. And but I've obviously since fallen in love with acting. And I work really hard. I've always worked really hard, which I think is the key to any success.
And my second question is, do you have any dream roles that you wish you could have played or that you want to play?
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to play, I like musicals, so I'd like to play Gypsy in that. I'd love to play Mama Rose and Gypsy. That's the main one I think about. Otherwise, life unfolds in a way that always surprises me and something fantastic shows up that I didn't think so. But I'm also directing now.
Oh, good.
And I really like that. I direct Switch at Birth, I directed Jane Doe, and I just directed a film called The Year of Spectacular Men. So directing is kind of a really cool thing. It's a really cool way to use everything I've learned as an actor, as a musician, as a dancer, all together and putting it all together and putting it out there.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Hello there.
Hi, sweetie.
Could someone help this young lady?
Hi, my name is Kella, and my question is, how did you feel on your first day of acting?
My first day? Terrified. Absolutely terrified. It's something that I still get excited and scared at a new job because, you feel exposed and, you feel like you forgot what you were new or you wonder if you're the right person for the part. So yeah, I felt a little bit scared. But that's the thing, I keep trying to do things that scare me because otherwise you just don't get out there. So keep doing those things that scare you, sweetie.
Thank you.
Very good question.
Two questions. First of all, what age were you when you wanted to do acting?
How old was I when I wanted to act? I did my first play actually when I was like 12. But I didn't really, maybe like 18, 17, 18. My daughters are actresses and I kind of waited till they were 15 or 16. I think that's the best time.
The second question is, where did you go to learn acting?
I learned on the job for the most part, but I also went to acting class in New York. And I still, sometimes I have coaches and I sometimes go to class. My husband teaches a class, I go to that class. It's good to keep learning, keep trying, keep moving, moving forward and be in a safe space to really try crazy things. So I also take improv classes too, which is really fun.
Cool.
Thank you, sweetie.
You. What's your daughters, what are their favorite movie of yours?
Gosh, I don't even know. I don't even ask them. Like, they won't watch Howard the Duck because when I start kissing the duck, they just can't take it. And they're old, they're like 21 and 25. So they haven't really seen that much of my stuff. Honestly, probably they just say Back in the Future, but they really haven't. I don't think they've seen Red Dawn or they've seen Some Kind of Wonderful because I married the director. So that would be doubly mean if they haven't seen that. Bad to their dad, bad to their mom. So I don't know.
Well, that's why they haven't seen Howard the Duck is they felt a little threatened by that
it's
duck.
True.
It's like, sort of cheating.
My daughter was just on Conan and she did a whole bit about that.
Yeah. Hi there.
Hi. About the predictions for 2015 and Back to the Future, I know this is Detroit, but do you feel kind of bad that the Cubs still haven't won the World Series?
We were all really hoping for that. I do feel really bad about that. And I told them, I said, Bob, there's not going to be flying cars in 2015. That's just not going to happen. People just, they want somebody with a hat on, They don't want to be flying their own cars. But he said, got to do it. Can't make a future movie without a flying car.
Yeah, and the Cubs, it was like, on Back to the Future Day, I think was the last game that they lost or whatever. So everybody, even in New York, everybody started crossing their fingers for the Cubs. It was amazing.
I know.
Yeah. Hello there.
Hi, sweetie.
Hi, my name is Nick. I was wondering what your favorite movie was when you were acting.
My favorite movie? I have a weird favorite movie of all time. It's Harold and Maude.
Yes.
I don't know why. When I was your age, I saw it like 30 times. It's strange. It's just that I love Hal Ashby. I love being there. I'm really sad I never got to work with him. That's my favorite movie, but yeah, I'm sorry. That and Gone with the Wind, but
yeah,
great movie.
Two good movies for you to check out, maybe when you're a little bit older.
Yeah,
maybe. Hi there, my name is Kyle. I want to say thank you for being here in Michigan, Detroit. Back to the Future trilogy has been a huge impact on my life, my little brother, my family, and I was just wondering if there's a prop or something special that you've kept from the movies all these years, and like, what did it mean to you? Why did you want to keep that?
I kept the prom dress, the whole prom dress. And the shoes and the everything, the earrings, my mother was really scandalized because I had to wear like a bustier thing and a crinoline. And when we were shooting, the dress was so obviously so tight. I'd just be walking around in front of 200 extras in my bustier and crinoline. My mom would be like, what is going on? I'd be like, it's a movie set, no one cares. But I have all of that my daughters can't fit in it. I don't know how I was that tiny. It's like a tiny, tiny dress. I also, for a long time, saved the boobs from Back in the Future, too. Because it was just a big plastic, like, chest. And but it got really, it was latex and got really smelly, and my husband threw it away.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Leah. We're fans of Dancing with the Stars. We're wondering, how did you end up on that? Did they call you or did you volunteer to be on it?
Anyone who does Dancing with the Stars deserves a gold medal. So hard. No, they just called me up and they were like, you have 5 minutes to decide whether you want to be on Dancing with the Stars. Like, some people, I think they give them months to get ready or something, but they were like, you want to do it? And because I was telling this beautiful young lady, I try to do things that scare me. Certainly scared me, and so I said yes. And I was also shooting Switch to Birth at the same time, so it was really hard. And my shoulder's still injured from it. It's really hard, but it's a great show, and I really admire everybody who's on it. And I just went a couple of weeks ago to with my cast from Switch to Birth to cheer on Niall, because he was on Switch to Birth, and we were all cheering him on. So I hope he wins.
Thanks, Leah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Here.
Woohoo!
Yeah. I'm a big fan. I love your movies, and my mom and sister watch your shows. So I got two questions. If you weren't an actor, what would you be doing?
I'm an excellent waitress. I do know that. I don't know what I'd be doing. I don't know. Gosh, I'm glad I'm an actress because I don't know what else I'd do. The easiest thing for me to do is to sing. Like, I only started singing in my 40s, and except for Howard the Duck, and singing comes easy to me, so maybe I'd be a singer.
What do you like to sing?
Anything. I like to sing country western, I like to sing jazz, I like to sing... And actually, when I was on tour here, Aretha Franklin came to see me and sent me flowers.
Well, nice.
Dear Diary,
yeah.
Queen of Soul.
Yeah.
And I was nervous.
And truthfully, if they would remake Back to the Future, what are your thoughts on that?
Remake it? I don't think they will until, like, Bob Zemeckis owns the rights, and he said no, and he's really rich, so he doesn't need the money. And so he really says, until I die, they can't make Back to the Future.
Good.
That's what he said.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, another movie that's enjoying a 30th anniversary is Space Camp. And it's an interesting movie because it doesn't seem to get a lot of love as part of that 30th anniversary glow, even though, I don't know, I have a warm spot for it. But it came out at such a terrible time, not, you know, just 5 months after the Challenger tragedy. So when you look back on that experience, you know, you're a young actor, you're excited for this movie to come out, but it's also coming out at such a bad time. Just what was that thought process for you? I mean, did you kind of go in knowing that this isn't going to perform well because people are not space-minded right now.
Oh, it was terrible. I mean, we had been so invested in the whole space camp, a bunch of wacky kids accidentally blast off in the space shuttle and have to land it. And the space shuttle blew up between the time we finished the movie and the time the movie was released. And it was horrible. I mean, we all felt terrible. We'd met a lot of people. We'd, you know, been into the space program and been really gung-ho about it. And yeah, that was weird. Yeah. That was really not a good thing. And that movie is interesting because I don't know if anybody understands how weird this is, but after the first day of shooting Space Camp, we were 10 days behind.
Oh, no.
Yeah, because they had no idea how to shoot it. They had no, they were like, it's going to be weightless. And we were like, okay. And then they were like, and we were like, how? And they were like, we don't know. And then we're like, we're shooting. And they're like, we know. So basically, we became a pantomime group, and we would do this.
Olmsburn at 2 o'clock. And they were like, Leah, you're a dancer, so you do it. And anyway, I recently met Joaquin Phoenix and reminded him of all this, because he was only 10 at the time. And so we were supposed to shoot for 3 months, and we shot for 6. So that was intense.
Did they actually sent you to the space camp? It's in Alabama, right?
Yeah. And they sent us to Cape Canaveral as well.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, I think it should get a little bit more love.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
For coming out, first of all, and I love your show, Switched at Birth.
Thank you.
You guys inspired me actually to learn to sign, actually, yourself. So, one of my questions is, when will the next season be released, and do you have any spoilers?
The next season is really weird. They've decided to hold it for an entire year, so January 17th or something, it's gonna come out. I think they didn't want it to make their new shows look bad, so they're gonna bury us. But yeah, I got to direct the 100th episode, and they also canceled us before the end, so we get to wrap it up really nicely. And it's a lot about the baby, and a lot about my bad marriage, because I'm now my husband's boss, and he's not into that. And, there's a lot of great stuff that happens.
Will you be doing any more of the ASL communities, scenes or movies or films?
Well, as you can see, I'm not very good at it, so probably not. But I try.
Thank you so much. Hi again.
Good.
Yes, hello again.
Hi.
I'm curious, do you like watching Star Wars?
I do. I'm not the biggest Star Wars fan. I mean, I'm a little bitter about that whole Princess Leia thing. But I do know my daughter just auditioned for the new one. Yeah, I don't know what part, they don't tell her, but she just auditioned for it.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
So you can bring it back into the family, get it back.
I'm hoping that she was auditioning for the young Princess Leia. But I don't know, they don't tell you. It's so crazy when you audition for this stuff, they give you fake sides and you have no idea what part or what the script is or anything. It's not really fair to actors.
Thank you.
One more. Did you meet Han Solo, Harrison Ford? Have you ever met him?
I did. I met Harrison Ford at George Lucas's birthday party, and I can tell you something, he has the softest hands ever. And I was like, dude, you're a carpenter. How come your hands are so awesome?
Oh, cool.
So there's a tidbit for the internet for you. Softest hands in the carpenter.
Maybe that's what, maybe he slipped off the steering wheel in the plane or something.
I was just going to say, as a big Star Wars fan, it's kind of cool to come to your panel and get Star Wars stuff. That's kind of neat. We had a chance to talk out there on the floor, and I was just sharing with you about how much your movies have meant to me and my family. I even put a Back to the Future reference in my vows, telling my wife that if an old guy ever showed up in a DeLorean and told me I had to go back in time to save our family, that I would gladly do it. And I've loved all your movies ever since I was a kid. And I wanted to ask you another question, and that is, when filming Back to the Future, because it kind of jumps around a lot, and I really like those plots where we're seeing people in time, but we see Marty back at a different time, and then again there and stuff. How much of that did you have to reshoot same scenes for? And how surreal was that, kind of having to come back to a movie and reshoot some of those parts that you had already done?
What was hard was sometimes they would use your close-up from when I was shooting with Eric Stoltz. And that was unpleasant, you know, because acting is like between two people. And I did shoot the whole scene where he wakes up in 1955. I shot that whole scene with Eric Stoltz, and I was like, for some reason they couldn't use any of my stuff, so that was great. I got to reshoot that because it was a completely different scene with two different actors, you know, it was weird. But the most that you can really see what they saved was the car chase, where Biff ends up in the manure and he's on the skateboard. They used all of Eric's stuntmen. So they had to somehow make Michael's hair look the same. So they kind of greased it back. They don't explain it at all, but you know, and the stuntman doesn't look like Michael Fox. He's much taller. Looks like Eric Stoltz. So if you watch the movie and you watch that sequence, you can see that they used almost all of the stunt footage that they had already shot of him.
That's cool. And Jaws 3 question. How you get attacked by the shark and it just kind of mauls you over and it looks like you were completely eaten but then you weren't. How was it working with the mechanical shark?
That's the funniest thing because I had lied and said I'd done all these movies and I hadn't done anything. So my very first day on my very first movie, they go, Leo, we have a stunt for you. And they push this button and this shark comes out of the water. I go, oh, they're so really trying to kill me off. And any film, that was my first day. And they also had this big 3D camera that they didn't know how to use. And so luckily it took a couple days to shoot that. But yeah, that was really stupid and scary.
You were great in it, so.
But I have to see it. Literally haven't seen it in 30 years. My brother went to see the movie and he goes, well, you laughed a lot. You just laughed a lot. And I said, okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Hey, it was a gig, man, right?
It was a gig. I was a starving girl in New York.
Hi there.
Hi, sweetie.
My name's Miranda, and I have a question. Who is your inspiring actor?
I'm inspired by a lot of people. I mean, the go-to person is Meryl Streep because she works so hard and she changes so much in every performance, but I was really inspired by so many people, and for me, it's people who I work with that have a really good attitude and are really, really fun and kind. You know, I immediately don't like an actor that's not kind to the crew or the people around them or their fans. I don't dig that. But Walter Matthau, I did Dennis the Menace with him, and yeah. I just love Walter because he could take the phone book and make it funny. He could take any line anybody gave him and make it funny, which funny is actually the hardest thing to be, honestly. I've done it all in the 33 years. Go back to that girl. And you know, someone who can bring heart and comedy is my hero.
Thank you.
Thank you, Angel.
And I think we're gonna just wrap up with these two final questions. Unless this young guy at the back. All right, you'll be my last one, little guy. All right, hi.
Hi, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
I've always wondered about actors and how they maybe create friendships and relationships when they do movies, especially as big as like Back to the Future was, you know, sometimes enemies, I guess. But do you keep in touch with Michael J. Fox, Christopher Lloyd, and does he ever ask you, Michael J. Fox, to help him finish it for partners?
I, you know, we don't. I, like I said, I see I see them here. I mean, luckily, we're going to do one in Philadelphia in a little while, and all of us will be together. So, and Michael hadn't been doing these, but I think he got some new medication so he can come out and not be super uncomfortable. So it's been really nice to see these people. I see Chris a lot, and I love him. And like I said, I've done a bunch of movies with him, but it's weird, you know, your life just kind of takes off and you right. kind of don't, it's not because you don't like people, but I do, I've been doing a fair amount of like TV shows where the prizes you win money for Michael's Parkinson's association, what's it called? Yeah, so I raise money for his group, and I just did Cupcake Wars for that reason. To win, and I did Cupcake Wars with my co-star from Caroline in the City, so that was really fun. Kind of had a double room thing going on. So I try to not only raise money, but raise awareness by doing benefits and TV shows for Michael. Thank you.
But this is sort of like a surreal experience because not just yourself, but so many people come to these events and then reconnect with people they haven't seen in decades at times. Yeah. And it is like these reunions on stage in front of you guys, in front of the fans, which is kind of special.
It's awesome.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi. We met earlier, and this is most people here probably. I have two things. The first thing, I just wanted to, you know, really thank you for making this such a great experience. I didn't get a chance to tell you earlier, you know, I didn't want to take up too much time, but my oldest daughter is autistic, she's 12, and we've been trying to transition her into things she might like that's more age appropriate, right? Mm-hmm. And it's funny, even from a few years ago, Howard the Duck happened to be on, and I enjoyed it as a kid and let her watch a little bit, and she loves it. In fact, we had to buy a couple of DVDs because she kept wearing it out because she'd watch portions of it over and over again. It's one of her favorite movies.
That's so sweet. Yeah.
And so I'll sit and watch with her because I can only watch so much Muppets and, you know, so it's really great. And you're one of her favorites. So, and then number two, you know, the experience we had talking with you earlier and now you're so personable. And I would imagine by Sunday at these conventions, you're probably exhausted. So, you know, what do you do to keep yourself, you know, motivated? I mean, you're so great when you meet everybody and you ask some questions. You know, it's just really wonderful experience. Do you find it hard to keep it going all weekend?
Well, no, you know what? I love being in the Midwest, because when I come to the Midwest, kind of, I'm like, oh, these are my people. Like, you guys know how to be nice all day. It's not like that in LA. But, I don't know. I think that I'm so grateful that you all came here, that you're willing to listen to me, and that you've enjoyed my movies, obviously, at some point. I mean, that's the dream of a performer, honestly. And I find it's really good for me as an artist to have contact, you know, because what happens sometimes with people when they get famous or whatever, they get super isolated and they forget what they're doing, who they're representing, who they're playing. And for me, I've always tried to keep my life more like, I don't know, just normal, because it's too hard to pretend I'm fabulous. It's just too much work, I can't do it. So, I just love meeting people here. It's so nice, and it's so nice to be here. And it's so nice to meet you, and thank you for sharing that about Howard the Duck. That's really sweet. I'm sorry you had to watch it a million times.
That's okay, I have to watch it another million times. So could my husband.
Thank you. And final question. Hello again.
Hello, young man.
My name is Jeremy, and are you in any movies currently in development?
Thank you.
Wow. He must be your agent.
Amazing. I have a movie coming out called The Wrong Side of Right, The Dog Lover, which is coming out soon. And I also am still waiting to see about a pilot that I did called 4 Stars. It doesn't look great. It's on CBS. I don't think it's going to make it. And I just directed a movie called The Year of Spectacular Men. I'm in it along with my two daughters, Madeline and Zoe Deutsch. And so hopefully we're going to do the festival route and that'll come out. And then I'm a free agent. I'm looking for a new job. So
hopefully. If you have any scripts, just send it her way.
I do.
Yeah.
I would bet that.
I'm working on something. But
thank you for your beautiful question.
Thank you so much. Well, Motor City Comic Con, I think we can all agree that she most certainly is fabulous. And so happy to have her here. Please give it up. Heading back to her table, so if you're going to autograph, then say hi to her.
Thank you so much for coming. Really appreciate
Hey.